So I want to just start off listening a little bit. And we'll talk about why that is, but let me introduce myself first. I'm Dr. Bennett Wood. I'm a freelance saxophonist, composer, arranger, music educator. I currently teach at Mineral Area College in Park Hills, Missouri. And I am here to talk to you today about transcription. If there were a title for this, it would be Transcription 101, or maybe Transcription, Intro to Transcription for high school jazz students. Or middle school jazz students. I think that the ideas that we're getting into today have applications a lot of places. I'm still applying these ideas, and I've been doing this for a hot minute anyway. So I hope that everybody gets some information that they can use out of this presentation. So we started off by listening, and you've probably heard from your band director, and from, you know, clinicians that have come to your school, or when you've gone out to play at a jazz festival, they've said, you know, if you want to learn how to play jazz, listening is absolutely essential. If you haven't heard that, man, those clinicians at that jazz festival messed up. And if I was your clinician and I failed to say that, then I messed up. So I'm sorry, but I'm saying it now. If you want to learn how to play jazz, listening is absolutely essential. This is an oral art form. That means that we learn to do first by hearing. And there's historical precedent for that. Going back to the earliest jazz musicians, you know, thinking back to like when Louis Armstrong was growing up in New Orleans, he listened to Buddy Bolden and Kid Ory. And later, you know, there were early jazz musicians like Bix Beiderbecke, who grew up outside Chicago and learned by listening not only to live performances, but by listening to records and imitating what he heard on records. And that tradition goes on. So all of your favorite jazz musicians learn to play by listening to the great soloists that preceded them. And it's especially important when we're talking about learning how to do jazz improvisation. So I don't want to dive too far down the rabbit hole of what is jazz improvisation, but let's start with what it's not. A lot of times there's a misconception that jazz improvising is just playing whatever you feel. Just play whatever you feel like. And it's really not that. It's at its highest form, jazz improvisation is expressing what you feel through the language of jazz. So in order to play what I feel, I first have to be fluent in that language. And the more fluent and expansive your vocabulary becomes, the better your grasp on the nuance and inflection and dialect and speech pattern, for lack of a better description, within the language of jazz, the more expressive you can be, the more you can tell us with your music what you feel like. So, again, if we want to play expressively, first have to understand how to express ourselves within the language. So, just as a child learns how to speak by listening and imitating their parents, brothers and sisters, grandparents, and the people that are around them in their lives, they hear them talk and they hear them imitate. Then they will imitate what they hear, right? Which can, you know, I'm a parent of a couple small kids. Sometimes that gets a little dicey. They might hear me say something I'm not supposed to say. So we have to be careful, right? So in the same way that a child listens and imitates what the parents and what the siblings say, if you want to learn how to speak the language of jazz, do the same thing. It's the same process. I guess it's a little different as musicians than what, you know, when you're a child, we don't get to pick who our our role models are in terms of learning speech, right? Like, I didn't get to decide, I don't want to learn to speak English for mom and dad, so I'll go, you know, pick this Shakespearean actor and learn to speak English from that. You know, I mean, that would be hip, but that's, we don't have that choice. But in learning to speak the language of jazz, you do get to make some choices about who your parents are going to be, your jazz mother and father. Like, you can pick who your role models are going to be and learn the language from them. So that's one of the things that's kind of cool about learning this. So for me, when I was starting to play and was trying to learn more about improvisation, I remember going to jazz camps, and in particular, the Widener camp, Jim Widener, former director at University of Missouri, St. Louis, used to have these summer camps really all over the state of Missouri, but there was one in particular at Drury University. And it was a big band camp, and I remember meeting with this really great Barry player, John Stone, and he told me, oh yeah, you know, you need to start transcribing. And I was young and really excited about the music, but also a little bit nervous and afraid to even ask. Like, I sort of knew what that was, but I didn't really know what it was. So let's talk about that. The literal definition of musical transcription would be to hear it, and then transcribe would be to write it down. When we talk about jazz transcription, though, and for the purposes of the presentation today, I'm not saying that you need to write it down. So you don't have to write it down in order to get the benefit. Now, we'll talk about, you know, there may be a point at which it's beneficial for you to write down a solo that you've learned. But start with just taking what you hear on the record and putting it on the instrument. Okay, so that was one of the misconceptions that I confronted when I was first getting started. I made a lot of really dumb mistakes when I was first learning how to transcribe because I just didn't know any better. And so what I hope you'll get out of the presentation today is you'll know better. you have the information to not fall into some of the traps that I did. So if you've got a pencil and paper handy, I'm going to start by giving you a couple of rules of the road or rules to learn by. You know, you heard rules to live by. This is rules to learn by. And keep in mind that there's no wrong way to do transcription. If I'm going to tell you, like, you don't have to write it out, but if it's more helpful for you to write it out, and like not writing a solo out is going to make a roadblock for you, then by all means do it. For me, notating on paper or in a music notation software, notating a solo was like an extra step that I had to go through in order to transcribe a solo. And so it makes more sense for me to avoid that, to simply learn the solo with the record, put it on. I'm a tenor saxophone player, learn it on the saxophone. And then if I want to write it down later, then that's fine. But again, there's no wrong way to do these things. These are just the things that I find helpful. So if you find a different way that works for you, great. But start with these. So try my way, and if you find a way that works better for you later, then do that. So number one on this list, if you're keeping score at home, you do not have to write it down. Doesn't say you cannot. It says you do not have to write it down. So the greatest value in transcription comes in internalizing the melodies in your ear and playing them on your instrument. So we're developing our ear. Again, we're talking about jazz as a language. We're developing our ear for the language, but then we're also developing fluency on the instrument. because we have to speak the language. So whether you're a saxophonist or a piano player or a vocalist, you know, if you're a scat singer, it's not as simple as just hearing Ella Fitzgerald do it and then you just do that, right? Like, it takes some work to be able to do that. Otherwise, every scat singer would sound like Ella Fitzgerald. So it takes some effort to translate what you hear to the instrument, is my point. Another thing about not writing it down. You know, if you think about it, music is really about memory. It's about being able to remember things that you've heard or remember things that you've learned on the instrument, whether it's, you know, you're learning maybe an etude for a lesson, or you're learning something that you're going to perform for all district or all state. Or even if it's just like for a performance, right? Remembering that, oh yeah, the conductor is gonna make a crescendo here. And so if we can anticipate those things, then we're going to play more musically. Well, jazz is the same way. It's and maybe even more so, because when we're playing, you know, in a setting where we're improvising, you have to remember chord changes, and you might have to remember melodies. And we want to also be able to access those ideas that you're transcribing. So not writing it down, and relying on your memory, exercising your memory, is one of the benefits of transcription. And then the last kind of sub point I have, under you don't have to write it down. After you've learned a solo and you've mastered every nuance of the solo, writing it out for posterity, like if you want to write it out so that you, yeah, I learned this solo, and you want to maybe come back to it at some point later on down the line. Or if you want to write it out so that you can come back and analyze that solo, that's a great thing to do. But the main point here is, don't feel like you have to write out a transcription. And if you fail to do that, that you're not transcribing. Now, most of the benefit actually comes from just learning something that you hear on the record, learning it on your instrument. Okay, so point number one, you don't have to write it down. Point number two, practice crawling or walking a few feet before you attempt an Olympic level marathon. Basically, what I'm saying is, don't pick solos that are way outside of your capabilities. I remember, again, I'll talk, kind of reflect on some of my early mistakes. I remember one of the earliest solos that I tried to transcribe was a Joshua Redman solo. Joshua Redman's a great tenor saxophonist. And here's how little I actually knew about what was going on. The piece, I was trying to write it out because that's what I thought I was supposed to do. And the piece that I was trying to transcribe was actually in a mixed meter. It wasn't even in 4/4 time. It was in like 5/4, 7/4. I don't even remember. But it was something that was way too complicated, like for the level that I was at that time. And I just didn't know. So one of the things that you have to do when you're starting out transcribing is you have to identify pieces that are, you have to identify solos that are within your technical capabilities. So if you're a brass player, you know, picking out a solo that's got really extreme high register that you can't play, I mean, you may still get benefit from it, but you may have to just take it down an octave. And so sometimes we adapt to make it work. But I mean, as a saxophone player, like, I can certainly think of tons of solos that even now are way outside of my technical capability. So don't start with that Michael Brecker transcription. You know, if you're a trumpet player, man, maybe don't start with Clifford Brown's solo on Cherokee. Or if you're an alto saxophone player, you know, maybe don't start with Charlie Parker's break on Night in Tunisia. So start with something that's a little more kind of down the middle. I'm going to give you some examples. So if you're like, well, cool, I'm ready to do that, but I have no idea where to start, I'm going to give you some examples of some solos that will work for all instruments, hopefully. So again, I said crawl a few feet before you attempt Olympic level marathons. So this is another thing to think about, is that when you're starting out, do not feel that you need to complete the solo start to finish. So, you know, I'm thinking of like if Paul Gonzalez plays 27 choruses of blues, but you're really only transcribing this solo for the first two choruses, you don't need to beat yourself up for not getting all 27 choruses. You can get a lot of benefit out of maybe just a chorus or maybe just a single idea. So don't feel like you have to do the whole thing. Now, I do think that in general, it's really beneficial to transcribe complete solos. One of the reasons being that you can see kind of the overall arc of the solo. It's not just idea that are completely unrelated. We see how the ideas are related over the course of the solo, and a lot of times kind of can see that the artist was building to something over two or three or 10 choruses, however many they play. But especially when you're starting out, I said, crawl a few feet, walk a few feet. Don't start out by trying to run a marathon. So start with, you know, manageable chunks. Point number three. So we had number one, you don't have to write it down. Number two, crawl or walk a few feet before you attempt Olympic level marathons. Number three, use tools or don't. So there are tools out there for you. Specifically, there are apps you can buy. Like I have an iPhone. There's an app for iPhone called Transcribe Plus. There's some software called Transcribe with an exclamation mark at the end. That's made by a developer called Seventh String. Both of those are great tools. There are other transcription softwares out there. And what those allow you to do is you can manipulate the audio. So I'll show you an example here in a moment, but I can take and slow something down, which can be really handy. I can, using a visual representation, I can cue it up to a specific spot, which again can be helpful. But use those tools or don't. Keep in mind that many of our musical heroes learned the solos that they learned when they were, you know, developing their musical vocabulary from record players, right? So they had to like pick up the needle and drop it back in the right groove in the right spot to get back to that lick that they were trying to hear. And I know that there are lots of you know, kind of the old school of musicians that talked about like wearing out records, or wearing out a portion of a record because they transcribe a solo and they would just move the needle back in that place and eventually the vinyl just wore out. So we have a lot of tools at our disposal. You know, one of the great things with all the music that's available on YouTube, I mean, you don't even necessarily have to buy anything. And YouTube also has a function that allows you to slow things down to half speed. I have not used that for transcription, again, because I tend to rely on these software tools that I have. But that could be the ticket for you. So that's an option too. So use the tools or don't. Number four, live with the solo for a little bit. And what I mean by that is after you learn a solo or learn a chorus of a solo or just learn an idea, make it part of your daily practice routine to play that along with the record. Okay. And again, there's historical precedent for this. The great tenor saxophonist Sonny Rollins transcribed the solo by one of his predecessors a generation earlier, Coleman Hawkins, made a recording of Body and Soul in 1939. And apparently Sonny Rollins for years played that solo as his warm-up because it's one of the greatest solos of all time. But that was not only a way to pay tribute to Coleman Hawkins, but also to make a point of daily acknowledging that vocabulary. And I'm sure that crept into Sonny Rollins' own playing. Now, while we're talking about that, I want to raise the point also that sometimes when we think about transcription and it's like, if I sit down to learn a solo, I know that I'm going to spend hours and hours and hours on it. And you might say, well, geez, Bennett, like you're spending all these hours and all you're doing is copying somebody else. You're just going to be a copy of Dexter Gordon or you're just going to become a copy of Sonny Rollins. But I just told you that Sonny Rollins played a Coleman Hawkins solo every day for a period of years. Does Sonny Rollins sound like an exact copy of Coleman Hawkins? No, absolutely not. There are other examples. Miles Davis, in his autobiography, talked about he had learned all of Dizzy Gillespie's recorded solos, and he couldn't play as high as Dizzy, so he learned them down an octave. But does Miles sound like Dizzy Gillespie? Well, yeah, there are points early in his career where he sounds like he's using some of Dizzy's language, but he didn't turn into a Dizzy Gillespie clone. No, he has his own sound. And there are tons of contemporary examples too. So I don't think that any of you are at risk of becoming a clone of Lester Young or a clone of Oscar Peterson or whoever your favorite musician on your instrument is. You should learn as much as you can from them, and you will find your own voice through understanding how they express themselves musically. So live with the solo. Live with your transcription for a little bit and make it a part of your daily routine. And then the last transcription rule to learn by is, and this phrase actually was stolen from a great tenor saxophonist, Ralph Bowen. I saw him do a clinic and he said, if you're going to cook a chicken, make stock. If you're going to cook a chicken, make stock. So what was he saying? Well, let's say you roast a chicken and you cut the meat off of it and eat it for dinner and have leftovers and make chicken salad. And eventually you get all the meat off the bones and you just have a chicken carcass there, right? Well, you could throw that out, or you could put it in a pot with some water and some vegetables and some herbs and make chicken stock. And then you can make soup with that. So his point was not just about cooking and not wasting things, but he was really saying, if you're going to spend a bunch of time transcribing, which that's the roasted chicken part. Like if I'm going to learn a whole solo, if I'm going to learn Sonny Rollins solo on Tenor Madness, don't simply learn that solo and then move on to the next thing. Like, find ways to use what you learned there in other places. So the example that I'll give you is we're going to get into some transcriptions today. And you're going to hopefully find some ideas that you like. And so what I hope you'll do then is practice playing those ideas. Practice playing them in the original context, but then also practice playing them in different contexts. So if I learn a lick that's on a blues in B flat, oh man, I really love this lick. Cool. So then I would practice that lick, practice using it in F. You're going to have to transpose it, right? But transpose it to F, transpose it to key of C maybe. Maybe you've got a, you know, your band is playing an arrangement with a blues in E flat. Well, you know, you can transcribe it to that key as well. And then there's some other things that you can do. Like you can change up the rhythm of the idea. So let's say maybe you transcribe something that's played in a swing context. So, you know, if we got a, like a 12 bar blues and like, you know, one of these kind of ding, ding, da, ding, ding, da, ding. So it's got like kind of a swing feel to it. Sorry, there may be a little bit of audio delay between my keyboard and the recording. We'll see if it swings or not. But we could take that same idea, and if I had like a Latin groove, instead of, so if it's one and two and three and four and right, so I could then apply it to a straight eighth context and make that idea work there. So again, the idea is that if you find something that you like, you want to try to use it in as many contexts as possible. And again, to go back to that language analogy, if I find a new word that I like, then I might practice using that in different contexts, so that it becomes comfortable, a comfortable part of my vocabulary and a part of my speech patterns. And eventually I'll move on to other things. But that last point, if you're going to cook a chicken, make stock. What that means is, if you're going to go to the trouble of transcribing a solo, find some things that you really like in that solo, and then practice using those, practice applying those ideas in different settings. All right. So now we're getting to the real kind of meat of this presentation today. And I'm trying to keep an eye on time, because I know that Dr. Jefferson doesn't want me to run over too much here. So I'm going to get back to that, the second point, which was crawl or walk a few feet before you attempt Olympic level marathons. Okay, so the idea is that we want to identify things that are going to be beneficial to you as a musician, but not so technically demanding that becomes a stumbling block, and not so far outside of what you can hear and process and put on the instrument that you just get frustrated. Okay, so what I've done here is identified three. This is a very kind of clickbaity kind of idea, but here's the headline, if you can imagine it: three jazz solos that every high school jazz musician should know or learn. Okay, so are these the only three? Definitely not. You should learn other solos. Are these the best three solos that a high school jazz musician should or could learn? I don't know. It's the ones that I came up with. Am I absolutely the best at this? Yes, definitely. Definitely. But no, I think that these are three that are accessible. I think that regardless of what level you're at, as a musician, that these are solos that can be attainable. So, you know, again, depending on where you are in your development, like you may have to build up your range a little bit, or, you know, maybe it's like, oh, it's kind of hard for me to hear that note. And you may have to practice that. But one of the things that, that I think it's really important for us to do, especially when we're starting out, with anything new, but especially like with jazz transcription, just be patient with yourself and go slow. The more complex and difficult, I hesitate to say difficult, the more demanding the music gets, the more we need to slow down and the more we need to take our time in learning that music. So the first example that I've got here is J.J. Johnson's solo. J.J. Johnson was a great trombonist. And this is the title track from his album Blue Trombone. So there is a trick to this particular solo. And it's, I'm not giving you like a hack or anything like that, but it's a trick in the sense that it could be kind of misleading at first. So this sounds like it's a blues in F at the top of the chart. But then once we get into JJ's solo, he's playing a blues in concert B flat. Okay, so piano solo that we hear up front, there's, I think, three choruses of piano that we hear up front. That's in the key of F. But then you'll hear him change keys to B flat right when the trombone comes in. So let me cue this up here and let's give a listen. B flat now. Okay, so we heard a lot of notes there. Not a lot, but I mean, there was a fair amount that went by there. So, again, we're going to start with, I'm not literally going to slow this down. We're actually going to transcribe this first one. I've never learned this solo, so I will be transcribing this with you. And I'm going to walk you through my process so you understand kind of, and you can hopefully, through seeing it in action, be inspired to try it on your own. Because I'm not very smart, and if I can figure it out, I'm pretty sure you can. So let's go back. I'm going to try and find exactly where his solo starts. Or sorry, where the trombone comes in. Okay, so about 51 seconds into the track is where he comes in. Now, what do we do next? Okay, so we're transcribing. I already told you we're not going to write it out. So we're going to start actually without an instrument. Now, I told you I'm a saxophonist. There's not a saxophone in sight here. I'm going to be transcribing onto piano. I'm not a pianist. Again, I've never transcribed this solo. We're all doing this for the first time. Okay, so buckle up. The first thing that I'm going to try and do is internalize this. I'm just going to listen to it initially. And so I'm going to try and hear it back a couple times. And I'm just trying to identify the first note. And at the point that I can confidently sing that note, then I'm going to try and find it on the piano. But I'm going to start by listening. Listen to it a couple times. And then when I think I've got it, I'm going to listen to it again. And then maybe listen to it one more time. And then I might try and sing it and see if I feel like I've got that first pitch. So let's listen. Okay. Okay, so I think we've got three notes at the start there. Let's hear it again. Do, D. Okay. So I'm not sure exactly what the pitches are yet, but I know we got three notes to start. Ba, ba, da, da, da. I think that's the first interval. If you're playing at home, try and sing it. Okay, so I think it's da da dee da da dee dee da. Let's not get ahead of ourselves. Da da da. I think those are the first three notes. Again, I don't have a great voice. I know this. You're probably laughing in your classroom. That's fine. But you should be trying to sing this as well. And your voice probably sounds a lot better than mine does. Guys, be aware that sometimes, and I'm saying guys like men, be aware that sometimes it's helpful to sing in the falsetto, especially as our voices change. It's sometimes hard for us to hear down here and match the pitch. So that's why I actually sing in the falsetto a lot while I'm doing this, because it makes it a little bit easier for me to match pitch, and I'm still not very good at matching pitch. But that's my recommendation. Okay, so I'm pretty confident about that now. Da da dee. Let's see if I can figure out what notes those are. So, oh, I guessed right. Okay, now there are only 12 options for that first note. Da happens to be the note. I happen to guess right. Okay, but let's guess wrong. Is that higher or lower than the first note? Da. I think that's the first note again. We got to go back and listen one more time. I missed it. Da 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 da. I started on this. Is that higher or lower? Da da. Sounds lower, right? Da. Ooh. Okay. That's not it. Da. Going up from that first note. Well, not the first note. I guessed right first. So, but let's. Da, da, da. Okay. So I just went up chromatically until I found the pitch that I was singing. So you got to be pretty secure in singing the same pitch that you're hearing. But that's what it is. Da. And then that first idea. Da da dee. I think that's what it is. Let's go back and listen again. Okay, so that's the first idea. Now, if at any point in there you happen to find a note that's not the right one, there's only 12 options, right? So, and it's 11 options because there's only 12 chromatic pitches. There's only 11 options after I know that, okay, my first note is F in this case. And then da da, I go to that note. So let's say da da, that's not the right note. da da, F B flat, da da, da da, da. Okay, so that's the process. It probably doesn't look glamorous, or it really doesn't look glamorous when I do it. But that is the process. I could get ahead of myself and guess notes on the keyboard. But I really prefer to slow it down and sing along first and become really secure in my ability to vocalize the notes and then put them on, in this case, the keyboard or the saxophone, or if you're playing trombone, whatever instrument it is. So we got that first idea. Is what it sounds like. Again, I've never transcribed this before. I'm a saxophone player. I don't play piano. All I'm doing is listening, and I'm faster at this than probably a lot of you will be the first time you do it, because I've done it a lot. So just be patient with yourself. Slow down. And sometimes literally slow it down. I'm going to give you another example, but let's listen to a little bit more of this solo. Just to kind of get a little further into it. So this is like the melody. Okay, that's a great idea right there. So he plays da da dee. Same notes from that melody that we transcribed earlier. So this is about a minute in. Minute 03. So we play. Goes up to an E flat there. Okay, so again, all I'm doing is just kind of listening, seeing if I can sing it, and then try and put it on the instrument. Again, the process you're seeing right now is sped up a lot. Like the first time I sat down to do this, it would have taken me an hour to get this far. You may be faster than that. You may be slower than that. That's okay. Be patient with yourselves. But start with singing it. And in fact, what I'd recommend to do if you're going to like work on a transcription as a class, I would learn the solo singing it first. Sing it all the way through first, or whatever segment of it that you're going to learn. So if you were just going to do the first two choruses or the first chorus, learn to sing the first chorus and be accurate about your pitches, vocalizing it before you try and put it on the instrument. So blue trombone, this is a JJ Johnson solo. I love this solo because it's not so many notes that it's impossible. He's thematic, meaning he uses some of the same ideas with a lot of repetition. Those are all things, those are concepts that you can use, even if you're not using the exact licks. You can use those concepts in your own playing, but the licks are great too. So you should do both. Both learn from the exact ideas that he plays, but also, you know, as you transcribe and as you play the solo, then maybe step back and think about, okay, what's he doing here? Like, what makes this work as a part of the solo? So I hear a lot of that thematic kind of stuff in the solo. Yeah, I mean, if you transcribe that much of that solo, you'd have a wealth of really awesome ideas to play over blues. Okay, so that's one solo that I think would be a great, that's one of the three jazz solos I think every high school musician should know or learn. Second on that list is Miles Davis solo, on the Sonny Rollins tune Oleo from Miles Davis album called Bag's Groove. And there are really fantastic solos that are also, I think very approachable, they're within reach for high school players, from Sonny Rollins on tenor saxophone and from, Horace Silver on piano on that same album or on that same track, actually. Oleo from Miles Davis. I think it's the Miles Davis All-Stars. And the name of the album is Bag's Groove. And then another Miles Davis solo. You know, I like Miles, when you're starting out, in part because he plays simply. He plays ideas that swing, and he plays ideas that are interesting and really beautiful and profound, but they're accessible. And you know, sometimes playing simply is one of the like most hip, innovative things you can do. And that's what part of what makes Miles Davis so great. So Miles solo on So What from Kind of Blue. And there are also fantastic solos on that same track from, John Coltrane on tenor saxophone, from Cannonball Adderley on alto saxophone, and then a short solo from Bill Evans on piano. So in all of these examples, there are solos from other instruments as well. But with the J.J. Johnson solo on blue trombone, the Miles Davis solo on Oleo, and the Miles Davis solo on So What, I think those are approachable for all instruments, even drums. You know, learn to, again, we're starting with singing the solo, right? So drummers, you're not excused from transcription. You should transcribe drum solos too, but transcribe melodies first and transcribe improvised melodies. So, you know, I think that, you know, my favorite drummers to play with, my favorite drummers to listen to are drummers who play melodically. And what better way to learn to play more melodically than by learning first melodies, learning to sing melodies, and then learn to play them on the drums. So I want to show you one more quick example. This actually comes from the second solo that I think every high school jazz musician should know or learn. And this is that Miles Davis solo on Oleo from Bag's Groove. And this might freak you out a little bit at first because it sounds super complicated. Okay, so that's the first eight bars of that solo. This is a solo on the harmonic progression is B flat rhythm changes, or it's based on the George Gershwin tune I've Got Rhythm. But there are a whole bunch of jazz tunes that use that same chord progression. There are contrafacts. That's another term for songs that use the same chord progression as George Gershwin's I Got Rhythm. So there are contrafacts of I Got Rhythm. The first eight bars, he plays this idea. And this one I've listened to a lot, so I'm going to jump right in on kind of some of it. So he plays da 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 da. Again, I'm sorry, the pitch is terrible. Da 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 da. Okay. I knew that it was either 1, 3, or 5 of the chord, and I was just kind of guessing there. Da da. But that's the note. Okay, so I'm using transcribe for this. So, again, I'm singing it first and then I'm putting it on the piano. Okay, so this is like that if you have like a grandfather clock in your house, or Sometimes you hear it in like courthouses will have bells, carillon bells that play this. Right. So Miles is just quoting another melody. And this is another thing that, you know, kind of brings up when we talk about approaches you can take with improvisation. We're really just creating melodies. So Miles just stole one from somewhere else. So he uses that melody to start. Whoa. Okay. That sounds like it's going to be really hard to get. Right? So I'm going to cheat. Not really a cheat. I put this in transcribe. I'm going to cue it up to, it's queued up to the exact spot. Let's slow it down. So I'm just going to get the first two notes. I slowed down to 50%, and you can do 50% on YouTube as well. So da-da-da. Now I'm getting like I'm like nine notes in, but probably we should start with just the first two, right? Okay, I finally guessed the right note. Yes. Oh, that's not right. That's not right. And then eventually got to. Nope. There we go. Oh, I better check that. I'm not sure if that's exactly the same. Yeah. Right. So, again, the process is listen, 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 listen again, then try and sing it, then go back and listen. So, I hope that this is helpful. If nothing else, to just, if you are ever transcribing and you feel a little bit ridiculous, you can go back and think, well, Dr. Wood looked like a complete doofus. And I, at least I don't look like I'm doing that. No, but I hope that you at least have a concept for where to start. And just be patient with yourself. Be slow about it. The harder the music gets, the more we have to slow down and be patient with ourselves in learning it. Because ultimately that's what leads to mastery is, repetition, playing it right, you know, many, many times over. And in transcription, it starts with hearing it right. So I hope you'll take some of what we talked about today to heart and check out these three solos. J.J. Johnson's solo on Blue Trombone from the album Blue Trombone. Miles Davis solo on Oleo from Miles Davis All-Stars, the Bags Groove album. And then Miles Davis solo on So What from the album Kind of Blue. There are millions of other fantastic solos out there. You should all... look for other solos on your own, that you want to transcribe. But I think everybody ought to start with, you know, some things that are in the wheelhouse, some things that are within their technical capabilities and, within their range on their respective instruments. Again, if you're a trombone player and like you're playing a Miles Davis solo, you're going to have to take stuff down an octave. I understand. Do that. If you play baritone saxophone and, you know, you're playing a trumpet solo, yeah, you're going to have to take it down, or you're going to play it down from where the trumpet plays it. That's okay. That's fine. If you're an alto player and you're playing a tenor saxophone solo, there may be some notes that are lower than what you have on your horn, so you have to adapt those things. That's fine. Especially when we're starting out, though, make sure that you're doing solos that are within your capabilities until you find somebody that you really idolize on your instrument and you want to, you know, play one of their solos. So, you know, I haven't mentioned any saxophone players. I'm a saxophone player. So for me, it was one of the early ones was Dexter Gordon. So Second Balcony Jump from the Dexter Gordon Go album. That was like one of the first ones that really grabbed hold of me. Charlie Parker's solos, all of them are great. But especially his solos on like Now's the Time and Billy's Bounce, like those were blues solos that really helped me figure out how to play the alto saxophone. So I hope that this will get you started on your own jazz transcription journey. And thanks for letting me have a little bit of your time today or over several days, however you broke this up. And I hope to see you and get a chance to hear you play in the future. Keep swinging.